A warm welcome to you all and a very happy Independence Day, guys. Today we are celebrating our 72nd Independence Day, and on this Independence Day, let's remind ourselves that freedom is just not about our rights. It's also about others' rights. It's also letting them have their own voice. It's also about respecting their opinions. Okay, so with this, let's begin with the first news of the day. Mahadai tribunal allows Karnataka to divert water. Now, what is this tribunal all about? What is this issue all about? Let's dig the basics. Now, in this picture, this is the northern portion of Karnataka, northern part of Karnataka, the Belgavi district. This is Maharashtra and this is Goa. And this is the place, guys, just below Bandori called Bhimgad. This is the Western Ghat area. All right. Now, this is the place where the Mahadai river originates and it crosses across the border, enters Goa where it is called Mandovi River and then sinks into the Arabian Sea. Now, the issue is regarding the sharing of water between Goa and Karnataka. Goa needs water to sustain its ecology and Karnataka needs water because there is a scarcity of water in this portion of Karnataka. All right. Now, a rift broke out which eventually led to the formation of the tribunal in 2010. Okay. And yesterday they released their decisions. And the decision is that tribunal allocated Maharashtra with 1.33 thousand million cubic feet of water, Goa with 24 and Karnataka with 13.42. Now, Maharashtra is also one of the catchment areas, guys. All right. Hence, Maharashtra also has a stake in the water. Now, this very tribunal derives its power from the Interstate River Water Disputes Act of 1956. Now, this very act was promulgated during the times of reorganization of states. Okay, and it was enacted under the Article 262. Now, you have to remember this. Now, another point is river water issue comes under the state list. Okay, only state government can make or amend any law regarding the river water issue. Army officers move Supreme Court against prosecution. Now, what is this issue all about? Now, there is this thing called as Army Force Special Powers Act of 1958, according to which a state can be declared by central government as a disturbed state and army and policemen can be deployed in that particular state to maintain the law and order. And during that situation, the army and policemen can conduct raids, interrogations or whatever required, based on the situation to maintain the law and order. And they are very much immune against their actions. All right. Nobody can drag them to the court of law. But however, in July 2016, hundreds of families in Manipur went to Supreme Court seeking probe against the alleged fake encounters by the army and the police, to which Supreme Court replied stating that there is no absolute immunity from trial of a criminal court. That means Supreme Court took away the very blanket of immunity from the army and police officers. Now, this has made army and police officers very vulnerable, because now they can't arbitrarily take any actions as such. So this has made army officers to go back to the Supreme Court asking it to take its verdict back. All right. Now, this is the case all about. So we have to wait and see how the Supreme Court would react now. And as I said, this immunity is derived from Army Force Special Powers Act of 1958, also called as AFSPA. Rupee breaches 70 mark against dollar for the first time. Now, there is a fall in rupee value against dollars. Now, it fell after the news of Turkish economic crisis came out. The Turkish currency is on an all-time low. Okay, and it's a classic example of a one world, one economy. If there is any economical disturbance in the one part of the world, its repercussions are felt in the other part of the world also. Okay, but however, experts say that we do not have to worry as it's because of external factors and not internal. The depreciation is because of the external, not because of any inflation or any administrative failure inside the country. Okay, the depreciation is in line with other currencies. What does this mean? This means that not only India, even other currencies are affected. That means relatively we are at the same place. So we need not have to worry about that. And rupee has not weakened as much as other currencies. So it's a good news for us. And other good news is positive to inbound tourism, textiles and clothing. Now, inbound tourism will be affected by this, positively affected by this. The people who are coming from outside our nation, you know, the foreign tourists, now they'll spend more in India because the value has gone down, right? They'll spend more, and the more they spend, the more it is good for our economy. And also the textile and clothing industries, they can sell more in the international market because the prices in the international market will be lower compared to any other products. Civil Aviation Ministry proposes a new bidding model for greenfield airports. Now they are switching from revenue sharing model to fixed fee per passenger model or fixed yield model. What is revenue sharing model, guys? To put in simple terms, it is to share whatever is earned. All right. And fixed yield model is a fee is fixed per passenger who walks in. Now, what is the real difference here? Now, let's say there is an airport which is taken care by company XYZ. Now, the annual revenue of that airport be 100 crores. Now, the government would say that it would share 50 crores with the company ABC and keep the other 50%. That is the other 50 crore. But in fixed yield model, the company will be paid based on the number of passengers who would walk in. Now, this is very much advantageous. How it is? It will push successful bidders or the company to attract more passengers because it is dependent on their profit. Now, to get more profit, they have to attract more passengers. Now, they'll start giving discounts, coupons and everything. Now, this discount will make traveling more affordable for passengers, which will eventually lead in the development of aviation sector. Okay. And the second advantage is much more transparent as headcount is easier with newer technologies. Now, it is very much accountable. Now, with all these CCTV cameras and latest artificial intelligence, we can know the number of people walking in and walking out of the airport every day. Simultaneous state legislature and Lok Sabha elections. Now, it's a very hot topic, guys. Now, this can be one of your questions in main or perhaps an essay topic. Okay. Now, I have come up with a few of the advantages and disadvantages, and I challenge you to deliberate on this and come up with some more advantages and disadvantages. So some of the advantages are reduced election costs. Okay. As both are conducted at a time, cost is low, clear mandate of people. People would know who to select in the center and who to select in the state. Reduced burden on administrative machinery. Most of the times our administrative machinery is engaged in electoral activities. Now they can focus more on developmental activities, which shall avoid policy paralysis, which will lead to the economic development. And a number of disadvantages are domination of national parties. You know, when a bigger party, a national party or a national leader comes in, he would outshadow the regional parties or the regional leaders or the local leaders. Okay. And what if there is no clear mandate in the election, guys? Right? Now, what would they do if there is no majority? Will there be elections again, or will they have to wait till the next elections? This we have to think about. And what if a government in a state falls before 5 years, right? Should they have to wait till the next elections that would happen after 5 years, or should they have to declare a presidential rule? What is the solution for this? So these are some of the things which we have to deliberate upon. So let's see who would come out with the answers and whose answers I can see in the comment section. Massive army reform underway, says Defense Minister Nirmala Sitharaman. Now in one of her speeches, she has spoken about the reforms which is likely to take place in army. They have been given below. It's very much self-explanatory. You can just pause the video and go through them. But however, I'll explain the last point, which is very important. Delegation of powers to service headquarters and lower functionaries. It's one of the important reforms here, wherein the powers are delegated to the service headquarters and lower functionaries. And it will ensure faster decision making in procuring ammunitions and troops in day-to-day requirements, or perhaps in emergency situations also. So let's say there is a warlike situation and the people at the front, they need ammunitions and arms. Now they can't wait for the approval from the top order, right? Because it might take time. So for the quicker decision, the delegation of power has been suggested here. So this is for the day, guys. Have a great day. Bye-bye.